Hey guys, how's it going? Thanks for tapping on this video. I want to talk to you today about 10 amazing albums of Christian Jesus music that you probably have never heard before. Hey, so thanks again for watching. My name is Landon, and I love talking about the Bible and Jesus and things that I love. If you're new around here or if you're not, I'd love it if you would like, comment, subscribe, and share. If you don't know how YouTube works, those are things that you can do that tell YouTube that you like the content. So if you don't like it, you know, watch something else and God bless you. But if you do like it, that'd be awesome because that tells YouTube how you feel and that benefits everything involved. I've got a resource for you in the link below. I've got a free Bible overview PDF that I'll send you if you send me your email address. I also have this resource. It's called Rediscover Your Love of God's Holy Library. I can't even remember what I called my own magazine, but it's a Bible study magazine. It's full color. It's got some art. It's got some comics. It's got some memes. It's got some reference material. It's got some journal material. It cannot decide what it is, but what it definitely is a fresh, new way to encounter Scripture. The general premise behind it is that you would see the Bible the way that God sees it. And all the info for that, either print or digital, is in the link below in the description. All right, here we go. So I love music. I have a ton of CDs and a ton of records because I'm a collector, and I've been collecting music since I was in high school. I love the Beatles. I love all this stuff. You know, don't judge me. And I love Jesus music that's good. And when I was in high school, I used to think that there was no good Christian music because I was irritated by the cheesiness of contemporary Christian music. And then I started digging and found so much cool stuff that is either under the radar or it used to be popular or the genre isn't as popular anymore or whatever. And there's so much amazing stuff. And I want to share some of them with you. So here we go, 10 amazing Christian albums you probably have never heard of. If you have heard of them, you know, then you rock and let's have coffee. Here we go, coming in at number 10, I've got Satan Is Real by the Leuven Brothers. I've got this on CD, I love this album. It is from 1959, it is a gospel record. It is crazy, it's written by two brothers, Charlie and Ira Leuven. Let's play a little clip of it.
Satan is real, working in spirit. You can see him and hear him in this world every day. Satan is real, working with power. He can tempt you and lead you astray.
So it's that old-timey folk gospel. Interestingly enough, this album is actually really popular amongst non-Christians too. If you can get past the cover art that seems ironic but really isn't. In fact, I read that the two brothers painted that 16-foot-high wooden Satan themselves. It's just absolutely killer gospel folk from top to bottom. If you're into that genre, if you're not, the lyrics are incredible. It's on Capitol Records, it's a classic. And I hope you enjoy it. Coming in at number 9, I wanted to bring Reverend Gary Davis' Say No to the Devil. I couldn't find it. I couldn't find my CD copy of it, and my kids were about to go to bed, and that's where my CDs are. And so I grabbed Delirious, The Cutting Edge, and I want to talk about Reverend Gary Davis and Delirious, because you may have heard of this one, I'm not sure, but Reverend Gary Davis is a pastor who just also happens to be a blues singer, and he has a song called Say No to the Devil. And it is swampy, gross blues at its finest with just killer lyrics. I know what you're thinking. Both of the things I have referenced so far have kind of anti-Satan themes, which is interesting. This record, which I'll just say, let's just say they tied for 9th, is called The Cutting Edge. It's by a band from England called Delirious. This is my family's copy that I still have. We used to listen to this in our car on CD all the time. They're so British, like, I wanna go deeper, but I don't know how to swim. Let's play a little clip of that and a little clip of Reverend Gary Davis if we haven't as well.
And the one who wrote it all is that I'm living just to fall. I'm more in love with you. And the one who wrote it all is that I'm living just to fall.
up into the jailhouse. Say no. He'll lead you up into the jailhouse. Say no. Well, the devil is a deceiver. Won't treat nobody right. Say no to the devil. Say no.
Basically, Delirious was born out of this worship movement in England. The songs are fresh. A lot of them wouldn't be able to be sung in a church because the lyrics are just unique. And I don't say that pejoratively. It's awesome music, whether you grew up with it or not. And Reverend Gary Davis is an obvious. All right, coming in at number 8, we've got the man, the myth, the legend, Sufjan Stevens, just kidding, Sufjan Stevens, Songs of Christmas, Volume 1-5. Yes, Sufjan Stevens has written 5 Christmas albums, or has he? Because coming in at number 7 is Sufjan Stevens' Christmas albums, Volume 6-10. This dude has written 10 Christmas albums. He sings classics like Silent Night, Angels We Have Heard on High, stuff like that. The earlier albums are really like indie folk with like banjos and guitar. And if you've never listened to Sufjan, his voice is angelic. And his delivery is so soft and patient. It really puts a new spin on Christmas music that so often is really loud, wonderful, and bombastic. And I like that take on Christmas music, but this is pretty amazing. And then volumes 6-10, because 5 Christmas albums aren't enough. There's 5 more, and this is where it gets a bit weirder. There's like sticker packs in here, which I'm obviously like all about. But it gets a bit weirder because one of them, here it is called Christmas Unicorn. And it is I would say it's a mockery and a subversion of the idea of Santa at the same time, while also embracing that like mythical lore becomes a part of things. I know that sounds insane what I just said, but it's a really cool song. And then the best song on any of these records, in my opinion, is called Justice Delivers Its Death. It's the second last song on the last of the 10 albums. Let's play a little clip of that.
Oh, I see the end. Everyone's waiting for death. How do you measure its worth? Justice delivers its gift here on earth.
It's extremely beautiful, emotive music. There's also electronic songs in here. There's a Prince cover. It sounds very like ramshackle and large, and it is. That's what these 10 albums are like. I listen to all 10 of them every Christmas because I'm the worst, and there you go. Coming in at number 6, we've got a band from New York. They're new, they're current. They're called Young Oceans. This album is called Suddenly. It's from 2017. I've been listening to Young Oceans for about 8 years. I discovered them in 2012. A buddy of mine texted them to me. It is ambient post-rock, extremely bombastic worship music that is very poetic. There's a song on here called Only the Sound. Let's play a little bit of that. That song has really impacted me. I don't know how to say it in a different way than that. But I have this on record. I love the lyrics of Only the Sound. What can open our eyes when we're deep in the night? only the light of your face. What can open our ears amid toil and tears? Only the sound of your voice. And it's simple and it's beautiful. If you've never listened to this, oh, is there a CD copy in there? Whoa, I didn't even know that was in there. Mini copy. I have it on CD and record. Zip-bop-bop-a-doo. So if you've never listened to this band, I would highly encourage you to. I think the music's amazing whether you're a Christian or not. And if you happen to be a Christian, which I hope you are, you'll love it even more because of the spiritual impact of this content. All right, coming in at number 5. Here we go. The Welcome Wagon, another band from New York. It's a husband and a wife duo. They've only played a very, very few concerts. I saw them in concert at Wheaton College when I was in college. And I love this record. I got them to sign it because I'm a dork. So there you go. They signed it. I love you guys. I love this album. This is my favorite of their albums by far. There's a specific track, track 4, called He Never Said a Mumbling Word. And I want to play you a clip of it.
But he never said a mumbling word. Not a word, not a word, not a word. Not a word, not a word, not a word. Not a word, not a word, not a word.
And it is, a song about Jesus' road to the cross, and he never says anything. It says in Isaiah, like a sheep before his shearers is silent, he said not a word. And it is, I listen to this song in the lead up to Good Friday and Easter every year. It is spiritually rich, hermeneutically rich, and also artistically beautiful. I can't recommend this record highly enough. They're current. Some of the stuff in the booklet is amazing. It's like, where is it? Look, check this out. Why does our pastor preach from the Bible in our church? And it's just got that kind of, I wanna take good care of my Bible. I wanna read it. I wanna study it. I wanna believe it. I wanna memorize it. I wanna obey it. I wanna share it with my friends. Lit, oh, check that out. God's word is like honey on my bread. Yea, sweeter to my mouth, sweeter than honey to my mouth. And these are some of the things that I'm dedicating my life to because they've impacted me so strongly. So to see artistically valuable content that hits these themes, as you can imagine, is very exciting. All right, coming in at number 4, Washington Phillips. This is probably the most or second most obscure of these. Washington Phillips was a street performer, as far as I understand, in the 1920s. And near the end of his life, someone said they wanted to record him. They recorded some shellac 10 inches, which are extremely old records that play on a wind-up phonograph machine that I actually used to have one of those. But I never had any of Washington Phillips because they were so expensive, because collectors love this guy. He built a guitar-type harp called a celestophone, and he basically just like nailed string to a board and tuned it. Like, this guy is as raw and as real as you can get. Some of these songs are literally 100 years old, and some of them are gonna be 100 years old soon. He wrote a song called What Are They Doing in Heaven Today? Let's play a clip of that.
What are they doing in heaven today? Why sin and sorrow are all done away. Oh, peace is bound like the river, they say. But what are they doing not now?
To me, it was just such a fresh take on something I've never heard anyone talk about or sing about. The idea of the lifestyle of people currently in heaven with Jesus. It's incredibly comforting. It's beautiful. I can't recommend this record highly enough. It's called The Key to the Kingdom. I feel like David Letterman in the 90s. There you go. Coming in at number 3, got my buddy, my boy, John Guerra. He was just with me here in Phoenix at Phoenix Youth Con. It's lit! And this is an album that, interestingly enough, was actually distributed by Vinyl Me Please, which is probably the most popular vinyl subscription service in the world. I was a member of it for several years. And this album has made me cry many times because of its staggering beauty. There is a song called, where is it? Yeah, If I Was is pretty amazing. Where is it? There it is. There's a song called Side to Side.
If I knew what you went out to find, I would walk with you from side to side.
This is dense music. If you've ever read some of the Psalms or Proverbs and felt like it was really dense, and it may not play well in a modern church because it's too quick and fast, and people maybe don't want to pay attention to a more detailed, complicated lyric, like oil running down the beard of Aaron or something. John's your boy. He has a record from last year, too, that has a song called Citizens. I don't know. He's my friend, so I'm kind of biased. But if we weren't friends, I would be his fanboy, because I love this record, and I'd highly recommend you check it out. Coming in at number two, Bob Dylan. Yep, did you know that Bob Dylan was a professing Christian from the late 70s until the early 80s? And I certainly would not judge if that salvation was real or not, like other people have chosen to do. I don't think that's a good thing to do. And I don't think everybody is always aware of what has taken place. And that's okay. I love these records. There's three of them. There is Slow Train Coming from 1979. There's this one, Saved. And then there's another one called Shot of Love, which is a super dorky picture of Bob Dylan looking at a flower on the cover. And I'm into it. This record is rock gospel. And Bobby, Robert Zimmerman himself, this is one of the easiest records to find in used record bins in America, because a lot of people love Bob Dylan and don't love God. And so they find these albums grating. I love them. The lyrics are incredible. Slow Train Coming, the one from 1979, is on Rolling Stone's top 500 greatest albums of all time. Here on the inner sleeve, it says, Jeremiah 31:31, "Behold, the days come, says the Lord, that I will make a new covenant with the house of Israel and with the house of Judah." And let's play a bit of that song, Saved. This is an old copy, and so clearly I shouldn't be inserting it into the cardboard because it's breaking. Super glue. And so this song, Saved, is a song that I equate with Easter. It's got a very fast pace, a great drum beat, and wonderful lyrics. If I remember them correctly, "I was blinded by the devil, born already ruined, stone cold dead as I stepped out of the womb. By his grace I have been touched, by his mercy I've been healed, by his hand I've been delivered, in his spirit I've been sealed, I've been saved by the blood of the Lamb." And it's not just good lyrics, the music's awesome. It's got the harmonica, all the Dylan classics. All right, here we go. Coming in at number one, if you've heard of this and you've listened to this, man, let's hang out. And if you haven't, listen to it and let's hang out. This is the Abyssinian Gospel Choir, the album Shaking the Rafters from the director, from the direction of Professor Alex Bradford. I bought this at Amoeba Music a long time ago, probably, I don't know, 10 or 11 years ago. And it is a straight up gospel choir record. The amount of emotion per song will blow you away. It was originally released in mono, on vinyl, in 1960. The song from it that I want you to hear a bit of is called Glory Train.
Glory train.
And so I actually covered that song in an electronic band I was in. It's a stunning song. I want to ride that glory train. I feel like words will not do the power of this music justice, because the level of spiritual impact from these tracks and from the emotions and spirits and hearts of these choir members is so palpable that I've met and read tons of people on the internet who love music, who are atheists, who have no interest in God, and the power of music like this or some other gospel compilations like This May Be My Last Time Singing or Fire in My Bones or some of those gospel compilations from the early 2010s, people are like, they love the music. And there's something awesome about that, because God says to create everything with excellence. And I'm not saying that atheists should love all Christian music. I'm saying, how remarkable is it when someone does the musical part with such excellence that even a person who doesn't believe in the message can enjoy it? And even better than that, Christians can be edified by it and worship to it and learn from it and grow in it. And that is why I picked this as number one. Abyssinian Gospel Choir, gonna ride that glory train, gonna ride that glory train, gonna ride that glory train. I'm a dork. Thank you guys so much for watching. This has been Top 10 Christian Jesus Music Albums that you probably have never heard. If you have heard of them, I'm sorry. And I love you guys, and I'll see you next time.